So I guess it's time to start my talk. And my name is Alexander Korotkov. I am from Postgres Professional, and today I will talk with you about some project which is Postgres with integrated blockchain support. And I guess everybody heard about blockchain hype. And the first question I think would arise in your heads is, what the hell is that? Why you are trying to do such weird things? Yes, and so really there is a big hype around blockchain, and there are heated debates about whether we should apply blockchain there and here, and what problem it could solve. But personally, I would like to see what we can try to extract from this technology, what would be useful to regular database management systems like Postgres. And then I came to idea of Credereum project, which bringing some of properties of blockchain into Postgres database management system. Not all the properties of blockchain. It doesn't turn Postgres into Bitcoin, Ethereum, etc., but some of properties, and let's see what properties there are. At first, user signs every performed transaction, and database management system proves correctness of query results to user. So in client-server model, when users interact with database management system, user have completely trust to the data which was returned from the database. So there are DBA or database owner who can compromise the data in any way he wants. Idea of Credereum is that once users get have to sign all his transactions, then database management system can return to user not only resulting data set, but data set with proof which shows you that this data comes to you because it was result of this and this and this and this transactions. And the system actually is still left centralized, so there is some, you know, owner of particular database instance who is up to remain it up and running and so on. But, you know, this database owner is not so free in malforming data, because if it would malform data, then a user can realize that. And idea of privacy of data also remains, because there is still database owner, Postgres, ACL, and you know, DBA can set up access privilege as in the same way as in regular Postgres. Yeah, so you know, basic schema looks like this. So that user sends to the database not just some transaction, but transaction with digital signature, get commit acknowledge, and another user, or probably the same, sends a query and get query result with proof, proof based on digital signature. And using this scheme, some problems still persist. You know, I put there some quotes from original papers of Bitcoin. The first quote says that digital signatures provide us the part of the solution. So we basically understood how we can use digital signature in database management system. But another quote is telling us that there is still double spending problem, And this is double spending problem is exactly problem which cause blockchain to use proof of work, proof of stake, etc., which cause people to mine and so on. And so how we can have an analogy of double spending problem in the to the world of database, because in database you not necessarily are dealing with any of assets, it could be just data. And analogy of double spending problem in the database would be keeping multiple states of the single database, and you could, and database owner could show some state to one user and some another state to another user. So it's it can doesn't maintain actually a single database. And idea how to defend from that is to have some trusted storage where we place some hash of database state and save it there. And then, assuming this trusted storage is not comprised, we have a guarantee that database is in single state every moment of time. So this trusted storage could be, you know, just a single server, which we are, which all the parties are trusting that this server performs okay, or it could be some multiple service which votes for every hash by some Byzantine protocol, etc. It could be, for instance, public blockchain, so it's possible to save some data to Bitcoin or Ethereum or etc. But Credereum is agnostic to this storage. It could be anything. So, and then let's go deeper into details of how that works. And then after the details, I will show you something from example how a current prototype of this system is working. And I will have to make some introduction into a widely used in cryptography method. It's Merkle tree, and a particular implementation of Merkle tree is Merklix, which is a mixture of Merkle tree plus radix tree. So Merkle tree is a tree of hierarchical hashing. The probably most common example is BitTorrent, which uses Merkle tree for files. So it's divide file per chunks. Each of chunks have its hash, and then it hierarchically made hash of hashes and so on. And in the root, it have single hash that validates single file. And important property that you can, using this single hash in the top, you can build a proof. So when, for example, one participant of torrent sends to another participant of torrent some piece of file, it also gives a proof that this piece of file is really it's really under this root hash. So it shows us the proof, and this proof is relatively small because it's a logarithm to the total number of chunks. Merklix tree is a bit different because it allows you to work with not only just chunks, but it makes you work with key value pairs. So by idea, it's just radix tree, which is also prefix tree and so on. It's a tree when your k is a path from root to leaf, For instance, you could, while traversing from root to leaf, you can read, for instance, toaster, you know. Merclix brings here also hashing. So you calculate hash of each non-leaf node as concatenation of prefix plus hash of corresponding node and plus another prefix, another hash of corresponding node, etc. And in the leaves, you have just hashes of the values. Mm-hmm. And the property of this data structure that each hash validates contents of corresponding tree branch. And one very good thing you can do with this Merclix tree is that you also able to construct proofs. So you can prove to another user which knows top hash of Merclix tree, you can prove him that this K has this value in this tree identified by given hash. So you have to provide the path to given given key, yes, and given value, and also you have to provide the hashes of side nodes, and then another side can recalculate hashes and check that yes, it's okay. Really, this tree contains this key value pair. Idea of in Credereum, idea that we represent the whole database as single Merclix tree, and then transaction is just a transition of this Merclix transition from one Merclix tree to another Merclix tree, and user actually sign this transition. Thanks to Merclix tree, we can not transfer the full database state to the user in order to sign it, but we can transfer to him proof of state of rows before transaction and proof of state of rows after this transaction. Yes, and user can validate that that's really match the changes he made in the database, and then put digital signature. Yes, so there is some basic scheme how that works. So in Merclix proof, we have some internal nodes, leaf nodes, which corresponds to old row version, you know, and node correspond to new row version, some node corresponding to delete, but node still persists, but it's marked as deleted row. And there are some side nodes. For them, it's only known their hashes, but user can should validate that these hashes match to each other. So it means that he signed that he didn't change anything other in the database than is shown by this Merclix proofs. And you know, when we do such transitions to this transition from one Merclix tree to another is okay already. We could build a chain of them, but problem is concurrency, you know, because making getting a digital signature of process from user is interactive process which could take significant time. And if we would have to globally lock our database for write for this period of time, then performance would be terrible. And idea that we allow multiple transactions to run if they don't modify the same data. Yes, but then we have to somehow merge the effects of this transaction. And here we come to idea of blocks. So block validates the block contains set of user transaction which its signature, and you know each user transaction bring our tree from one state to another, and in block also there are final state which is result after merging effects of all user transactions, and there are hash of blocks which validates all the content of this block, and these hashes are also in a chain to build so as in any kind of blockchain. And once we have hashes of blocks, then we can save them to trusted storage to validate that the state that there is a single chain, so it's not branching, you know. And assuming we have such blockchain and we have trusted storage, then we can build a proof for user that history of given row is so. So we have to build for each go to each block, and for each block build a proof for each transaction for the state of this particular key. So we should build a proof to prove that this transaction didn't modify this row, or it did modify, and show that the resulting state for a particular block is matching to effect of all the transaction. So we have to build all the proof of for every transaction in every involved block. And this project have actually be prototyped. In prototype, we have to make some representation of a key. And representation is a relation name and a concatenated primary key of a table. In prototype, it's restriction that it should be 64-bit integer. But it's just a restriction placed by a prototype. In principle, it could be, we could support any kind of primary key. And, you know, then our Merkle tree is a tree where on some level, you know, you have some subtrees are tables, and leaves you have rows. And this prototype is not very performant, so tree is stored, nodes of tree are stored in regular table. So it's not performant, but it was fast for the prototyping. It's available on GitHub. You can download it and build as a regular Postgres extension. You build that, install, then in database you need, you type create extension, then you create trigger on the table which you want to enable Credereum, and you execute this query after each insert, update, or delete, so you let Credereum to track every change in this table. And this is how usage of this extension is looking. Imagine you beginning some transaction. This transaction, for instance, inserts new row into the table. And then if you would just say commit, then database will throw an error because you have modified table which is tracked by Credereum but didn't sign your transaction. The thing you should do is to get select star from Credereum get change set, and this function will return you to Merclix 3, which give you proof of what have you changed in this transaction. And then you have to validate that these changes meets the actions you have performed. In this particular example, it's a single insert. And if it's correct, then you just sign the transaction and call a special function to send this sign, send this signature to the server and commit. On commit, server would validate your digital signature, and if it's correct, then everything fine and acknowledge it. Another function there is which give you history of given key in the database, and this history consists of set of Merclix proof, which shows you the history of changes of particular rows in and its digital signatures. So there is an example in Python. The examples are also in GitHub. And on this slide, there is some interesting part of that. Imagine you doing some insert to the table, and then there is a function get change set, which actually retrieves all the Merclix proof from the database to client side. Then it validates the tree is correct, and then it extracts change set into more readable form and returns it to you. And then in your application, you can validate that it's correct. So we know that we did one insert, and we know value which we did insert. And what we do is we assert that there is no updates, no deletes, insert only one, and the keys of the table are ID and value, and the value is what we did insert. Then if all the checks was passed, then we sign this transaction with our private key and send this signature to the server. This is how it looks data modification with Credereum. The one thing which you could see that, right.
Okay, it's probably important to note where did the hash came from? You populate it on the Python side, or it's provided by the extension from the database?
Okay, so it's provided from the database, but in Python you do full validation of all the hashes you receive. So if so you calculate it on both sides, and in Python you check, and inside the function get change set, which process the trees, it recalculate all the hashes and check they match. And if any of hashes is not matched, it would throw an error. Okay. So, and this is how looks getting a proof in a client. So, at first, in Credereum, we have some encoding of keys. So each key is identifies row in the database. And first, we know that we in table T we need a given set of IDs. And at first, we should encode that. And then there is also library function which gets you a proof from the server, and this proof would be also in set of trees. Then it validates all the trees that hash sums are correct, trees are correct, and so on. And then give your history in more readable representation. And this example just goes through this history and prints it in the terminal. So, but this approach of building proof of history have some problems because the complexity of building proof of history is proportional to the whole number of transactions in the time period considered. And for sure that doesn't scale. So it's okay, for example, you can play with it, but for real production systems, it's not acceptable. And this is one problem. And also there is another problem that side branches of Merkle proofs are covered channels for the data. So based on given Merkle's proof, user knows some prefixes for side branches and can do some assumptions about data that this user shouldn't see. Yes, and another issue is that digital signatures should be done by end user in order to system work. So, you know, it doesn't make sense if you have application, you know, which puts the same digital signature, you know, on every transaction from every user. So in order to system make sense, you have to do on the user end side the digital signature. And this and that means the user deals with actual structure of the database, with physical structure. So it might be kind of shortcoming also. And regarding problem of complexity of history proofs, which is probably the most serious problem of this approach, there are two approaches to overcome this problem, at least two approaches. The first approach is that not all the blocks have modified the rows which we are building history for. And then database owner can publish a bloom filter for every block to show which rows were modified in this block. For sure, this information could be compromised. So if database owner wants to fool its users, then it could falsify bloom filters. But user may request every block according to bloom filter and some more to provide, to make some sample control. And if database owner is falsifying bloom filters, it would be eventually revealed. Another idea that We can don't query the full proofs every time, but user can maintain partial replica on his site and update it incrementally. That would also some kind of solution of this problem. The possible future development of this platform would be not just to save hashes somewhere to trusted storage, and to also have some trusted storage for backups, because Credereum prevents database owner from database owner or somebody who have hacked, you know, the system and compromised him from falsifying data, but it doesn't provide the safety of data. So if everything is, you know, is erased, then you can just say that, you know, there is nothing matching your hashes, but the data is lost. And possible future development is to provide some, you know, some public blockchain where you save hashes, and some decentralized cloud where you store your backups, and this guarantees the safety of the data even if database owner is compromised. Yes, and there is some table which compares properties of Credereum project and properties of classical public blockchains like Bitcoin or Ethereum or etc. First, system time. You know, in public blockchains, you know, they are truly decentralized. The decisions are made by proof of work or etc. Credereum we would call a hybrid system. So besides it's reside on some particular server, but the decisions of committing transactions are made actually by users who place the digital signatures. It this is why we are calling this hybrid system. Data manipulation methods. In public blockchain, you are running smart contracts, while Credereum is actually a Postgres database with extension where you can work with regular SQL. In public blockchain, everybody can read anything if it's not encrypted, while in Credereum, the DBA can use regular ACLs. Write permissions in public blockchain is defined by smart contract. Depending on how you write your smart contract, it gives users ability to change that or that data. So in Credereum also it's a relational database where DBA setups ACLs for writing permissions to. Transaction validity. So which transaction is assumed to be valid? In public blockchain, it depends on digital signature of user who is authorized to perform particular transaction. And also there is a single smart contract interpretation rules. And you know, every participant of blockchain networks validates that smart contracts were interpreted correctly. But in Credereum, we are just relying on digital signatures, and the rest of thing is up to database owner who set up the ACLs. system availability, you know that in public blockchain you need at least one node up and running in order to be able to work with that blockchain. And in Credereum, which is actually a Postgres instance, so it's up to owner of this instance. It could it's shut down, then start, and so on. So guarantees of history immutability. So in order to guarantee that your history of changes doesn't go back in public blockchain, there are a set of proof of algorithms, including proof of work, proof of stake, etc. So in Credereum, we to have this guarantee, we are relying on external trusted storage, which could be in turn public blockchain, which with one of these algorithms or some other system which users trust to. So scalability of blockchain, I think it's subject of heated debate, because some persons say that it's impossible to shard blockchain, some persons claim that it's possible. So, but you know, Credereum is actually a relational database system where we have a well-known CAP theorem and set of another theorems that say how it's possible to scale databases. And so the conclusion, so Credereum is a platform where the owner of the database proves correctness of query answers, while database user is able to check those proofs. In order to check that there is single state of database, that it's not multiple branching states, trusted storage is required. Unfortunately, current prototype is low performant because it's built on top of regular tables and wasn't optimized well. But we can expect that performance of Credereum would be in times lower than performance of normal databases, because it has to do extra calculations of checksums, extra validation of digital signatures, and so on. But also, we can expect that performance would be in orders of magnitude higher than performance of public blockchain, which can perform only probably few or dozens transactions per second. Yes, performance of proofs is currently low in given prototype, but there are some approaches to improve it. And prototype of Credereum is published on GitHub. Everybody is welcome to download it, try it, and share feedback. And so that's all for now. I am ready to answer your questions. Right? Yes.
I have a question to answer. Mm-hmm. What question does it answer when it verifies?
You answer following a question that this data modifications was actually done by owner of this of provided public key. So every changes in the database is authorized using digital signatures, not more guarantees.
So if this was like company expenses, this would mean that I could verify that yes, the employee actually authorized this transaction.
Yes, yes. So you would find out what particular employer authorizes yes this change of particular role. Okay. Yes, DBA can't claim that some person, you know, did this modification because he don't have a private key of this person.
Can the DBA delete
It can delete transactions unless the hash is fixed to trusted storage. You know, once it's published in trusted storage, then DBA can't delete transactions so that it couldn't be revealed. Okay, Bruce, please.
That was actually my question related to that is whether I've always thought about this also for server logs, because right now somebody can go into the server logs and change a line, right? But if each line was chained to the next line, like the git history is,
yes.
Git history is a chain that goes forward. Has anyone ever researched sort of chaining all the transactions together so that
yes.
you couldn't have a gap in the middle, so maybe you wouldn't need to have a storage of all of the transactions individually, but merely the final chain would prove that all the ones before were valid, you just had to store that one.
Yeah, that's kind of hard, that's sort of one half of the blockchain. I'm not an expert, this is just okay.
Yes, yes. So it's also.
Even if you have a sequence of things, because someone could still go back and change them and change all the.
Yes, it could change and just recalculate all the checksums after that.
Recording of all the hashes and have a sort of a way to merge states, I think that's more what that does.
I was thinking more of the case where you have a hash and you know if that hash matches what you get, that you haven't lost anything.
I think that's a degenerate case of.
That's a limited.
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions? All right.
And I think it's probably related to this. To what degree do we have to, in order to do the proofs, I think the client's going to have to be pulling all of the data, sort of all the time. They have to have the full stream of transactions.
So you.
To verify that everything's...
I'm sorry, so you mean that user can get data and don't verify it proofs?
Well, for them to verify the proofs, they can. We can say, oh, well, I trust you, but if they want to say, no, I don't trust you, I want to go back and check the proofs, they have to be pulling substantially all the data from the database. Substantially everything that has gotten signed, they have to pull all that data in order to do any verifications of the proofs.
To do the Merkle's proof is actually the technology which allow you to don't pull all of the data. You know, it proves that under these hashes some particular data resides without pulling the whole data. You know. Yeah, so basically, you are talking about complexity of proofs, right?
Well, I'm thinking you probably have, in order to have confidence that this is all working, you need to pull all of them. You need to be scanning, in effect, all the, you have to be scanning all the data in the database almost all the time.
Yeah, so. So let me show some previous slide. So what this is idea of Merkle's proof. So in top of the tree you have hashes which validates the whole data set, the whole set of k value pairs, you know, but Merkle's proof is a technology which allows you to prove that particular key value pair exists under this top hash without showing the whole tree. This is idea. Yes, but you know, it's right that complexity of proofs is still a problem here, because even that we don't pull the whole trees, you know, but we are doing Merkle's proof, you know, but we are still doing this for every transaction. If even this transaction didn't touch a particular row, but this is in progress research, probably we will find a way to improve that. Okay, any other questions?
Mm-hmm. Something like this would prevent that, right? Because you need all the data potentially from both to ensure it's one continuous chain.
Otherwise, so the question is, can this work on top of bidirectional replication? You know, I didn't thought about that. You know that we have to save hashes periodically to trusted storage, and I think that restriction is that before sending some hash to trusted storage, all the history behind this hash should be synchronized across all the nodes. Then probably it might be working. I think so. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so it seems like no more questions. Thank you very much for attending my talk.